Holy heck, that's fast. Today on the BV3D channel, we'll be taking a look at the FLSun T1, a high-speed, clipper-based Delta 3D printer, and we'll do it right after this. I'm Brian, and you are watching BV3D. Hello, 3D printing friends, and welcome back. Okay, so today we're getting a look at the FLSun T1 Delta 3D printer. It's the smaller sibling of the FLSun S1. It promises some incredible speed and a good-sized build volume. So we'll talk specs, look at a few prints, and I'll go over what I like and don't like about the printer. I had an issue or two with it, so I'll talk about that too. Big thanks to FLSun for sending this over so I could show it to you. And now, here we go. First up, the printer's specs. The FLSun T1 is an enclosed Delta FDM 3D printer with a passively heated chamber. That means the enclosure simply retains some of the heat generated by the bed and nozzle. The bed has a spring steel flex plate with a textured PEI coating on it, and it can get up to 110 degrees Celsius. And the 0.4 millimeter nozzle can get up to 300 degrees Celsius. It features a direct drive extruder, and FLSun claims a flow rate up to 90 cubic millimeters per second. Now, it has a brass nozzle, not a hardened nozzle, so you won't want to print abrasive materials like carbon fiber reinforced filament or even glow-in-the-dark PLA. But FLSun does say it should work fine with regular PLA, PET, PETG, TPU, ABS, ASA, nylon, and polycarbonate filaments. As with all Delta printers, the T1 has a cylindrical build volume. That volume is advertised as being 260 millimeters in diameter and 330 millimeters tall. Kinda, sorta. That's gonna be a big talking point later in the video. And instead of a parts cooling blower located on the tool head, or end effector in Delta parlance, the T1 uses a high-pressure CPAP-style blower running at 30,000 RPM, connected down to the parts cooling ducts by a flexible hose to deliver air, and lots of it, to cool the current layer of the print before the next one gets printed. And as you might imagine on a Venn diagram showing a turbofan running at 30,000 RPM and a quiet room, those two circles are nowhere near intersecting one another. FLSun says the T1 has a maximum printing speed of 1,000 millimeters per second at a maximum acceleration of 30,000 millimeters per second squared. Rounding out the features, it's got a 4.3-inch color touchscreen, clipper firmware, Wi-Fi connectivity, over-the-air firmware updates, automatic mesh bed leveling, and it supports vibration compensation to help reduce ringing artifacts on high-speed prints. There's an onboard camera that FLSun calls an AI camera, but as far as I can tell, it just lets you see what the printer is doing. And there's a filament runout sensor, so it can let you know when you need to run out and get more. And all that for about $600 US. Next, I wanted to comment about the assembly process. The printer arrived safely, protected inside its cardboard box by foam packaging. Nothing was damaged, even though the box had a pretty deep gouge on one part. Assembly took about an hour to an hour and a half. I followed the small printed guide, and I didn't have much trouble apart from the guide being small. But if you're more of a visual person, there's an assembly video on the USB flash drive that comes with the printer. And if the small size of the guide is a problem, there's a PDF version of it on that flash drive as well, so you can view it on your computer and zoom in if you need to. The assembly video is clearer than the guide on a few topics, particularly how to work with the fragile ribbon cable connector on the touchscreen, so it may be worth 10 minutes of your time to sit and watch it so you have a good overview of the build process. So with the printer built, it was time to turn the printer on. The initial power-on sequence went mostly as described in the manual. First, I selected English for the printer's language. Then, I connected the printer to my Wi-Fi network. According to the manual, the printer should then have performed a self-test, but it simply went to the home screen. Since I couldn't find a self-test option in the printer's menus, I ran the calibration steps myself. This consisted of a vibration compensation calibration and then a mesh bed leveling operation. But the whole process only took a few minutes, and then I was ready to load some filament and try a test print. Now, it's weird having the spool partly embedded in the top of the printer. It feels like the cables and air hose that run from the top down to the end effector will get in the way a little bit. But in practice, it seems to work out okay. The only time the spool and the wiring get in each other's way is when the end effector is very close to the top of the printer, like when you home the printer. And if you have a spool that just doesn't fit in that cutout, there's a provision for feeding filament in from the top of the printer. The manual and the printer's menus don't quite match when you want to load filament. The manual has you going to the settings icon and then to the temp tab, but there isn't a temp tab. Instead, use control. And in control, the extruder controls operate as expected. Tapping the Into the Extruder from the top icon prompts you to select a loading temperature, which defaults to 240 degrees Celsius. While the nozzle heats up, insert the end of the filament into the guide tube at the top of the extruder. Once the nozzle is up to temperature, the printer will automatically start pulling the filament in. You may have to press the filament down to get it started in the drive gears, but the process worked pretty well. I mean, except for some hilarious static electricity antics. Anyway, with the filament loaded, it was time to print something. One of the things I printed was this fan silencer, which was pre-sliced and in the printer's list of files. It kind of reminds me of a stylized ceramic Christmas tree. I should have printed it in green with a star on top. So this took about 2 hours to print, and it does indeed do what it says it'll do. It reduces the sound level of that 30,000 RPM blower by a few decibels. I don't know if this was sliced with settings where the aim was to have it printed as quickly as possible, or if this was sliced with normal settings. Regardless, the surface finish is a little bit lumpy in a few spots, though it isn't super noticeable. But I do recommend printing this and putting it on the air intake on the top of the printer if you get a T1. And for the next print on the T1, I chose the pre-sliced Benchy from the list of files on the printer. It said it would take about 10 minutes, and really that's about all it took. This is a 10-minute Benchy. No, it's not the greatest. Yes, it has some problems. But also, yes, it's clearly a Benchy. There's an area on the bow that looks a little bit wrinkly, and the 3D Benchy license plate on the stern is largely just a smear, and there's a bit of stringing inside the wheelhouse. So yes, there are some issues. But then, this is a Benchy tuned for speed, not for quality. When I started 3D printing back in 2017, a Benchy would take close to 2 hours to print. So for something that only took 10 minutes, I kind of expect it to not be great. I mean, microwaving a pizza takes a fraction of the time baking it does, but again, you're gaining speed at the expense of quality. Hey, if you're enjoying this video, a subscribe would be great. That lets me know I'm making content you enjoy and you'll want to see more like it. Thanks! After the first two prints, I installed the FLSun slicer and sliced a standard 20mm XYZ cube. And like the previous Benchy, this was a 10-minute print. And it came out pretty good, though there are a couple of weird bands on the back of the X-axis where the layers are not quite stacked consistently. I don't know what's causing that, but otherwise, it looks pretty good. So then, I wanted to see how a Benchy that I sliced myself would turn out compared to the 10-minute pre-sliced one. So, like I did with the XYZ Cube, I sliced one in FLSun slicer. I wasn't happy that the preview wasn't really showing the 3D Benchy license plate, so I changed the perimeter generator in the slicer from Classic to Arachne. And that resulted in a better looking preview. I liked what I saw, so I sent it to the T1. This Benchy, using the FLSun slicer, printed in about 27 minutes. And I think it turned out better than the pre-sliced one. It doesn't have a wrinkled part on the bow like the 10-minute one. The surface finish looks nicer, and the corners of the wheelhouse are sharper and more defined. There is still a bit of stringing in the wheelhouse, but this is a much nicer looking Benchy. That Benchy used up the last of that particular spool of orange filament, but I had this other high-speed orange PLA, so I loaded that. I sliced and printed this Fidget cube by designer LaForest Labs. It printed in 49 minutes, and while it works, all the print-in-place hinges are functional, the surface finish isn't super great. It's lumpy and inconsistent in places. So I wanted to see if the filament was the problem or if it was something else. I moved the filament over to another fast printer and sliced and printed the same model in that printer's slicer, using 0.2 millimeter layer heights, same as I did with the FLSun slicer. This other printer took 18 minutes longer to print, so it was an hour and 7 minutes instead of 49 minutes, but it did a much better job with the surface finish. So I don't think the problem is the filament. Rather, I think FLSun has a bit more work to do tuning the slicer settings for the T1. The last print I'm going to show is most of Luby3D's Aria the Dragon. I say most of Aria because an issue cropped up that really bothered me. This was supposed to be a 3-hour, 40-minute print, but it never finished, and I'll talk about why in a minute. For now, let's talk about what the T1 was able to do. First, it was able to survive a filament break thanks to its filament runout sensor. See this line on the wing and the head? That's where the break happened, which caused the printer to pause the print and wait for me to feed it. And it was several hours before I noticed and reloaded the filament. The previous layers had cooled and contracted, so when it resumed printing, the new layers were offset a bit. But I was happy that it was able to resume, and I left it to finish what it was doing. Fast forward a few more hours when I checked in, expecting the print to be done. Instead, I found this. The printer was telling me the time-lapse video of this print was ready, which I found a bit odd considering the print wasn't finished. And once I cleared the time-lapse message, I found out why. The printer said the model was too tall to fit within the build volume. Wait, what? Well, hang on, we'll get to that. For now, we're still talking about the T1's accomplishments. The print quality looks pretty good on the lower part of the pedestal. That little droop of filament there is expected because of a steep, unsupported overhang at that point. But check out this weird banding. It's the same sort of thing I saw on the XYZ Cube. I don't know why the T1 sometimes has a hard time stacking layers consistently. It continued doing that intermittently until it got to the base of the wings. And it seems to have done okay after that, even past the line where the filament break occurred. I think if this had actually finished, it probably would have been okay as a display piece, since most of the issues are confined to the back of the print. So this model was scaled up to 250%, which makes it 325 millimeters tall, and in theory, that should easily fit within the advertised build volume of 260 millimeters in diameter and 330 millimeters tall, because 325 is clearly less than 330. But this model had only gotten to 284 millimeters tall before the T1 stopped, some 45 millimeters short of the advertised build height. For those who don't think in metric, that's almost 2 inches shy of the height part of the T1's advertised build volume. So why is that? Well, it turns out that Delta printers don't truly have a cylindrical build volume. Instead, it's a cylinder capped with a cone. And that 284 millimeter height, where the T1 stopped printing and threw an error, is how high that cylinder part goes. The conical part of the volume is a result of the way Delta kinematics work. One or more of the arms is already at its maximum travel and can't move up any higher to keep moving the end effector horizontally. So that conical part goes from 284 to 330 millimeters high, with the diameter getting progressively smaller as it goes up. So this is a rant, sort of, about how FLSun is marketing their printers. Personally, I think if a printer is advertised as having a particular build volume, I should be able to use all of it. I've known about the cone part on the build volume of Delta printers for a while, but I always assumed that when Delta printer manufacturers stated a cylindrical build volume, that I could access the entirety of it. In other words, my expectation was that the conical part of the build volume was a little bit of extra bonus build volume, since a cone is not a cylinder. FLSun slicer software certainly didn't know about the cone on top of the T1's actual cylindrical build volume, which, it turns out, is 260 millimeters in diameter and only 284 millimeters tall instead of 330. It happily let me scale this model to 325 millimeters tall and send that to the printer, wasting hours of my time and a bunch of my filament. So FLSun, I have a suggestion. Advertise your printer's build volumes without that cone. Then it can be considered bonus build volume for the smaller number of models that'll fit in it. And please fix your slicer software so it alerts users when a model falls outside that cone. And that's the end of my rant about the T1's advertised build volume. So now that I've covered specs, features, print quality, and complained about the build volume, I'll go over the things that I like and don't like about the T1, starting with the things I don't like. You just heard me go on about the somewhat deceptive build volume numbers, so clearly that's one thing I don't like. Another thing is that I don't think the T1's AI camera is doing anything AI at all. I don't think it's even recording time-lapse videos. The touchscreen says it saved a couple, but there's no way to download them from the T1's main sale web interface on Clipper. In fact, the timelapse.config file is empty, and the console occasionally shows unknown command timelapse render. So for all practical purposes, the only thing the AI camera actually does is allow you to watch what the printer's doing. I also seriously dislike the noise level of this beast. It sounds like a vacuum cleaner because that's effectively what it's using to blow air down into the end effector to cool prints. Last, the print quality really isn't there. I think FLSun needs to rethink how they've got the slicer set up. It's based on Prusa's slicer, but here's the thing. Prusa has the print quality settings separated from the filament settings. So in Prusa's slicer, you would pick a filament from the filaments menu and then pick a print quality setting like 0.2 millimeter quality or 0.2 millimeter speed or 0.15 millimeter fine. And FLSun has created a dozen filament presets, so far so good, right? But then they created just a single 0.2 millimeter print setting. And then they duplicated that one print setting a dozen times and renamed each copy to match each of those 12 filament presets. So in FLSun slicer, you pick a filament type, and then you pick the print setting whose name matches that filament type. And there aren't different print settings for other layer heights or ones that are slowed down for higher print quality. There's just a dozen of what amounts to the same profile, each one named for a specific filament type. So you're basically having to pick the same thing, but from two different menus. It's like they went to all the trouble to build on and rebrand Prusa Slicer, but then completely ignored its way of doing things. And so yes, I'm dragging on the software, but ultimately it's what tells the printer what to do. So what I want to see FLSun do here is step up and provide a good collection of print settings so that users don't have to spend endless hours tweaking and testing slicer settings to get a good print. And I don't mean having 12 copies of 0.2 millimeters quality and 12 copies of 0.2 millimeters fast, etc., each one tied to a specific filament type. I don't think it's that big of an ask for a 3D printer manufacturer in 2024 to have a decent set of printing profiles, particularly for a rebranded slicer. Okay, now that I've got that out of the way, I'll talk about the things I do like, and we'll end on a more positive note. The bed leveling and Z offset have been pretty much spot on. The Z offset, as determined by the printer, was good, but I did adjust it for slightly more squish after a couple of prints. The touchscreen user interface is straightforward and easy to use. I haven't had any issues controlling the printer with it. Wi-Fi connectivity and FLSun Slicer's ability to send print jobs directly to the printer via the network and monitor the printer's camera and status during a print works well. And last, the printer is indeed very fast. So that's the FLSun T1. It's big, it's fast, it's loud, and I think with a bit more work on the print settings from FLSun, it could consistently put out some quality prints. But as it stands, you'll have to spend some time tweaking the settings yourself to get the most out of the T1. Thanks again to FLSun for sending this over so we could get a look at it. And big thanks to everyone who supports the channel, whether with channel memberships or by using the links in the description. If you liked this episode, give it a thumbs up and subscribe so you don't miss new ones. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this one. And now that we're at the end, let's go print something fast.